on air in collaboration with women tech makers. This is the second in a series of informal interviews with female engineers at Google for us to learn what motivated them to embark on a career in computer science and to find out what excites them about the field today. We're lucky to be joined today by Mandy Waite, who's a developer advocate in our office in London. My name's Alison and I'm in Zurich, and we're also joined by Lynette in London and Maria-Elena in Dublin. So Mandy, thanks for joining us. Maybe you could start off by just telling us a little bit about your current role at Google and also the kind of projects that you've worked on in the past.
Okay, cool, yeah. So I've been working at Google for about 2.5 years now, started in September of 2010. I've been doing the same role pretty much all the time I've been here. I work for a group called Developer Relations in Google, where we work with developers to help them try to be successful, to help them be successful with our products and technologies. Previously, last year and the year before, I worked on AdWords, the AdWords API, helping developers and partners particularly get up and running, get them up to speed with all of the APIs that we have, and get them being successful with that particular API. Currently, I'm working on the cloud platform. The cloud platform is all of our cloud products, things like Google App Engine, Google Compute Engine, BigQuery, and lots of the data storage options that we have. And yeah, I work with partners in the UK mostly, and startups, getting them up and running with those products.
Cool. And you mentioned you've been at Google for just a couple of years. Can you tell us a bit about what you did before that?
Yeah, sure. I think a couple of years at Google is like a lifetime for most people. it may seem like a short time on paper, but it's been an extraordinary ride so far. So beforehand, I started my career at Kodak, working on video and that kind of technologies. I can talk a bit more about it later. And after that, I worked for Sun Microsystems, one of the big tech companies of the noughties, the dot-com boom people. Yeah, we were behind the dot-com, we drove the dot-com. I used to work on the Java programming language back then. I did pretty much the same role at Sun Microsystems as I do here. I worked with partners, mainly independent software vendors, helping them to get their products onto our platforms. Back in those days, they weren't as interested in our platforms as people are today in Google's platforms. We were on a big downslope and ultimately got purchased by Oracle in 2009, I think.
Cool. So, yeah, you've had a pretty long career then.
I'm really old.
So how did you come to kind of get started in computing? You know, what was the hook that got you started?
So it's really career-wise. So it started off with my career. Not really even just my career. At college, I was studying radio and television mechanics, and that involved a lot of video processing, that kind of thing. And once I started my career, I was working on electrical circuits. Many of them had logic gates, integrated circuits, those kind of things. They were the previous version of chips, things that were kind of designed to do one specific job and do that really well. And then later on, things got a bit more complicated as microprocessors came to the fore, things that could be programmed. And that was all part of my job as well, so I was working with them continuously. So once microprocessors kicked in, things got a lot more interesting in terms of computing. And I even started programming in PostScript, which is a document language for creating documents, which was used by, back then it was Kodak. We used to have these image processors. We would have a document publishing system that would process documents from a word processing system into PostScript and then print them on a printer. So that was my first programming language. So since then, I've kind of moved into a much more technical role, working on Unix systems and that kind of thing.
Cool. And what was it that you particularly, that kind of grabbed you about it, that made you kind of fascinated and interested to?
I just think that there were so many things you could do with it. You know, everything. At a particular point in time, everything seemed to be pretty much ordered. You know, there were things being created and such like that were new, but there was nothing like this. We started seeing videos, probably live recordings of robot arms in factories and things doing stuff that was really interesting. And it seemed like there was so much potential here. Things that you could never previously have imagined were becoming possible, and that's just tremendously exciting. You know, and the most exciting part of it is that it is things you've never thought of before. Not just doing things bigger and faster than you previously did, but just doing things that you could never possibly have imagined. And that really just grabbed my attention and made me want to work in it. So another thing, I actually made a conscious choice to say, oh, I'm going to go and work in computing. Yeah, I had a career, and my career went in a certain path, and that path led me to being a computer engineer. Yeah.
Cool.
Cool. And Mandy, what's the most amazing thing that you've seen created by computer science?
That's really difficult. I did have some advanced knowledge of this question, so I kind of looked at it and gave it some thought. But I'm thinking that, as I say, it's about all of those things that we could never imagine doing before. You know, not just doing things faster and better. Things like the internet itself. You know, we're fortunate enough to have somebody in our office who knows Tim Berners-Lee, which is just amazing because, you know, he invented the internet, and it's just a leap of innovation. You know, that we could never previously thought of. It takes minds like Tim Berners-Lee to actually come up with those things. So it's things like that, and social media. We could never really have imagined social media and the way that works. Mobile phones, even. Yeah, those kind of things are just amazing. Advances in science that would just not be possible without computer science. Yeah, and today computer science is pretty much everywhere. So it's driving everything. So I'm pretty much stunned by everything. And every day I look on Google Plus and see new products and things being produced that. They're just amazing. Yeah, they just make me, I just say, wow, I could never have thought of that myself. It's just amazing.
Wow. So looking forward, like, you know, if you could kind of jump forward sort of 5 years, even 10 years, you know, what do you expect to be amazed by?
I think 5 years in tech is a huge amount of time. I really do. I think 5 months is probably pushing it nowadays. I'm looking forward to, the next thing I'm looking forward to is, my vision of the cloud, I'm looking forward to ubiquitous computing. I'm looking forward to computing being everywhere, you know, it being like an electricity supply, almost like an electricity utility, where you just plug something in and it gets computing resources, and it can use those resources to do anything. You plug your microwave not just into an electrical outlet, but also into a network socket, and then it becomes active on the internet, and it can do things that, you know, you couldn't even possibly imagine doing it. Weighing scales that can actually record your weight and show you trends in your weight over a period of time, you know, that may say, look, last Christmas you put on 10 kilograms, and this Christmas you put on 10 kilograms. There must be a pattern here somewhere. Those kind of things. I'm really looking forward to that. So the Internet of Things, everything being connected, everything being ubiquitous. But mostly as well, I think, really, everything being hidden and discreet, you know, that it's not obvious to people that they're working with computing devices anymore. You know, everything works kind of interactively within the whole environment. There's nothing that stands out that you would recognize as a computer. A light bulb is a light bulb, but it's got a microprocessor in it. Same with a fridge and those kind of things. Everything is kind of hooked up and wired up, but it's not obvious to the user. And they don't have to worry about all of that stuff. They just get useful information back from it. And also the analysis of data that comes from all of those things and showing us trends and patterns that we couldn't possibly have looked at before. Example would be the flu kind of epidemic analysis that we've done through Google search before, and it's shown patterns of people searching for particular terms that have indicated where flu epidemics were actually breaking out across the world, those kind of things.
So welcome back. Apologies there for our connectivity loss there for a few moments. I think Mandy was so excited about the future of computer science and what it could do that she actually blew the system. So we'll try and keep a bit calmer now. So Mandy, just really as our final question, what would you advise someone who's in school right now who's thinking about studying computer science? What should they do to find out if it's something that they might be good at?
Okay, well, I'm guessing today that computer science is multidisciplinary, that you have kind of paths within computer science that you can choose. So I think it's probably deciding very early on of which path you're going to take. Do you want to become a programmer? You don't have to become a programmer, I guess, nowadays. I think it used to be very key to computer science back in the old days. Probably not so much nowadays. Do you want to do application development? Do you want to work on networking? Do you want to work on the social aspects of it? Do you want to become a founder of a startup? Those kind of things. And I think even if you do want to become a founder of a startup, you probably need some technical skills so you actually understand exactly what you're trying to do and what you're trying to achieve. So I think it's very important to work out early on, a very early stage, what it is exactly you want to achieve by going into computer science. But I also think, you know, even if you only study computer science for a year, you can get a huge benefit from some of the skills you will learn that will allow you to do powerful things with applications and such like that you probably wouldn't be able to do otherwise. For example, Google Documents has this thing called AppScript that allows you to really do exciting things with documents, you know, spreadsheets and presentations and those kind of things. AppScript is a hugely powerful tool, but you do have to have a little bit of programming skills to do it. And I think if everybody learned some programming skills early on, I think that would be very useful to them. But again, you know, as I say, if you have the option to choose a particular path in computer science, I think you should really give it a lot of thought about exactly what it is you want to achieve. We interviewed somebody, a very famous person yesterday called Ping Fu. She's the CEO, the CEO of GeoMagic. And she always wanted to make things, and it became very, very obvious. And I think one thing there is a danger of is entering computer science just for the sake of it, without really a clear idea of what you want to achieve. I think if you're a maker and you really believe in making things, and I think you can look at it and approach it from that kind of angle. If you want to become a startup and a founder, then approach it from that kind of angle. If you want to design cool things, you know, that kind of stuff as well, rather than actually just producing them, then that might be interesting. So I think it's very important to choose at an early stage what it is you want to do. And hopefully when you become an intern, you'll get into a role that's particularly suited to that need, and then you can move on to a career that really suits you, as opposed to something you're just kind of like shoehorned into.
Great, thanks very much for joining us, Mandy, and answering all our questions. Thanks also to everybody else who joined the broadcast. If you want to find out more about the Women Tech Makers series, if you go to developers.google.com/women-techmakers, you can see these videos there. We'll be back tomorrow with an interview with a software engineer from Zurich, same time, same place. And details of all of the CS On Air sessions are available on our Education On Air website. Okay, thanks everybody, and have a nice afternoon.